in.
No, the other side.
Should this one remain in?
Yes.
Ah, no, there are two slots, okay. Okay, no.
No, you have to let him do it.
It speaks Spanish and I'm not.
And
it should work out of the box.
It seems it will not read it.
No.
Yeah, it does not know the. It does not know the device probably.
I don't know.
No, but I can also move. You can move the computer over here, and then
and
we unplug it. We unplug it. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
And
then I move it over there.
I go. No, no, it's okay.
Because of this.
Sorry. Well, physical. Logic is so much easier than physics. You don't have that kind of. Okay. Yeah, it's fine. Doesn't have that.
Sorry.
Yeah. Yeah. So, but basically, what I will try to do is. First of all, I will try to explain what I mean by epistemological and logical pluralism. You will see why I bring in epistemological pluralism in a minute. The second thing is that I will explain a bit this when a consistency emerges. I will quickly go over a number of procedures and logics to show that you really need or that you have a diversity of approaches that are sensible, so that's a pluralism in a rather important way, I think. And then, unlike what I announced in the abstract, I will go through seven theses that concern inconsistency, and I will each time try to figure out what does this have to do with pluralism, basically logical pluralism. Okay, so now, first for the introduction, there are many forms of pluralism. I've often tried to explain what I meant by logical pluralism and then continue with the lecture, and time and again, people misunderstood me. So what I will try to do today is first bring in epistemological pluralism. I hope this will help to then make it more clear what I mean by logical pluralism and why logical pluralism has a role to play in that. Maybe it is good, I'm sorry, but when do I stop?
Okay, I said
you said 50 yes. minutes, but it's good to work in some direction.
Okay.
And then, like.
No, squat to. No, the watches are right.
5.5.
5.5? Okay?
Yes.
Okay. So, yeah, that's okay. I said that already. What did I mean by this title, paraconsistency is no big deal? What I had in mind is that the advent of paraconsistent logics do not, in my view, change much to the situation of pluralism in the sciences, at least not the kinds of pluralism I have in mind. There are relations with pluralism, but I think there's no dramatic change. On the other hand, I do believe that paraconsistency is, in a sense, in the beginning of its career, and that many more paraconsistent theories will play a role in the future. I think that the objections to paraconsistency from the old days, especially from classical logicians, sometimes also from intuitionists, were misdirected and rested on a confusion to some extent. So then I hope for many questions that I said already. And finally, I mentioned you, I will sometimes talk about the logic in the broad sense. What I mean about that is simply a function that assigns to every premise set a unique consequence. So that's something very general, and then logic in the specific sense will be a bit more different. Okay, now, Let's first go to epistemic pluralism. There is a Western ideal of knowledge, and this ideal, the ideal is that we try to obtain a unified and monolithic body of knowledge, and we try to have a justification for this whole body of knowledge. It can be internal or external or a kind of combination. That's not so important. But the first line especially is important, this idea of unified and monolithic body of knowledge. Now, I think this is an important ideal, but if you look at the history of the sciences and if you look at the sciences today, then that obviously is not realized. And if you think that it is realized, I guess you are completely wrong. You give a completely different, a completely wrong view of what actual science is. So what we have in reality is a set of theories that are very partial, that are partly connected to each other, but to some extent also unconnected, and that certainly are not axiomatized. And I mentioned some domains like mathematics, physics, and so on. If you pick any two of these, you will figure out that there is absolutely no good amalgamation between the two. There are always a number of points where either there still are problems or one does not help and does not, sometimes mathematics does not provide the right mathematical tools to, say, sociologists and things like that. Always problems. And of course, especially whatever is related to reductionism or whatever alternative you have for it, in order to make these sciences, scientific disciplines cooperate, this is not really realized, and we have no clear way how to do it at the moment. The second point is that for many theories there are alternatives, both in mathematics and in the empirical sciences. Sometimes the alternatives are extensions of other alternatives. The way in which geometry is taught in most universities goes like that. You start with just a few presuppositions, then you add a few, and sometimes it splits, but you build up and extend. But there are other cases where it is very difficult to see how you could bring things together. For example, we have several set theories that we think to be consistent. Today, the ZF or ZFC, GFC, and then there is the new foundations, and there are several others. But of course, you cannot put these together. In the new foundations, there is there is a universal set and also a complement as a consequence. Of course, you don't have that in ZFC and so on and so on. So you cannot put these together in any way that I see. And the same, of course, holds for empirical sciences. So there it's even better known what the problems are, or philosophers of science will give you a lot of examples. The third thing is that there is an absence of a concrete unifying framework. What I mean by that is that we have an idea how we would like, or how we hope that the sciences will get amalgamated, but there is no specific thing we can say about that. I was reading a few things on the way our brain is structured and neurological stuff. And it turns out that you can locate certain things and you can say a few things, but if you would ever try to explain human behavior, nobody knows exactly how it should be connected, even today, to either parts of the brain or mechanisms in the brain or certain, and so on and so on. So there is no concrete, unique framework. We have certain ideals, we have certain views, but... Now, all this does not mean that unification is not important. I think unification is very much important because it produces a lot of problems between different disciplines, and these are progressively solved, and as a result of that we got progress. We got a kind of internal dynamics that is not caused by information coming in, data, empirical data coming in, but that really comes from the relation between the different disciplines. Still, that does not mean we are going towards or that we are close to this unified and monolithic theory that still is on the top line. The first thing is that until now I was only talking about theories about the world, about parts of the world or aspects of the world. But if you look at methods and cognitive values, the situation becomes even much more dramatic, because these are applied to justify or reject or transform or select theories. But in order, if you introduce your methods and your cognitive values, the problems are, first of all, these are transformed themselves. Secondly, where does the transformation come from? A number of people have argued they should come from descriptive knowledge, and they can hardly come from just thinking. Okay, if you sit down, if you are Aristotle and you sit down and you say, what is the method of science? It is, well, you will not come at what philosophers of science tell us today. It's impossible to figure that out. So apparently we have to justify methods from descriptive knowledge in the sense that we can ask the question, given the kind of beings we are and given the kind of environment we live in, how can these beings best obtain information about the environment? Of course, our present view on what kind of beings we are and what environment we live in are unstable and certainly not final. So you have a kind of dynamics. But this seems like a sensible evolution on the fly, as it were, or a sensible justification of that. Some other problems, changes to one theory affect other theories, computational problems, especially related to complexity. I say some more about that, and then philosophical problems. So there's a lot of things in this epistemic pluralism. And then finally, five, I think, is that, not sure, no, six is coming up, sorry. When you look at conceptual systems and languages and logic, then you see that there is a need to change these as the theories change, and it is unpredictable and inimaginable even beforehand what they look like. Think about what I said about Aristotle and apply it to conceptual systems or to logics. Okay, it's quite clear that people could not have imagined beforehand that to what kind of theories and concepts you would come today. And then so all this is in a kind of constant dynamics. And if you try to think about it, we have the tendency to take a kind of what they sometimes call in English a kind of God's view or God's eye. God's eye. So you try to look at everything from the top. But of course, there is no unique highest point where we can go and look at science, its methods, its values, and so on and so on. And if you look at what are provisionally highest levels, well, again, you have to figure out that this is rather unforeseeable. Again, you cannot predict now what that will look like in one century or so. Okay. So the idea is there's the, or the what I try to argue is there's no unified and monolithic body of knowledge. There is no stable highest level, and it's even unpredictable what this highest level might be in the future. And this is especially related to the kind of transformation methods that we are applying. We have to figure out what these methods are. We are, a phrase that I like to use is, we are learning how to learn in the course of the history of the sciences, and we do not have it beforehand. Okay, so this was what I tried to say on epistemic pluralism. And now I move to logical pluralism, if nobody is complaining. And for logical pluralism, I think logical pluralism derives from the fact that if you think at what I said before, then first of all, we have theories in which there is an underlying logic. So the little L there is the thing that gives us the logic of a theory. Gamma are the non-logical actions of a theory, and the little L is what how we close these actions to obtain the theory. Another thing is that we need to explicate reasoning and function of applications. And the third thing is that we want to explicate reasoning in function of the transfer between theories. Now each of these three shows very easily that you need a lot of pluralistic, you need a multiplicity of means there. For example, most actual empirical theories have, and even a number of mathematical theories, have informal logics as their basis. And of course, we need then to look for an explanation of those. We need to try to figure out what is the underlying logic. We hope that, but it's only a hope, that many of these theories will function with classical logic. But they certainly do not all function with classical logic. So there's some this is intuitionistic logic I refer to. There are a number of mathematical theories, constructive mathematical theories, that have intuitionistic logic or something close to it as, or a variant of it as an underlying logic. And that's, of course, something that has been worked out. But apart from that, so apart from the classical mathematical theories and the constructivist mathematical theories, we have a number of other theories, like there are some mathematical theories that have a relevant or paraconsistent or even adaptive logic as its underlying logic. But of course, these things are not applied by mathematicians, for example. They are mainly taught out by philosophers to illustrate something, to make a point, to show what might be done, what theories we could have, but they are not they are not used in practice. Okay, so that gives you...
For the empirical theories, by informal, you mean that also the meaning of the non-logical terms may play a role in L?
Or? No, you put informal between quotes, because what I mean is that there's no given formal logic that functions there. Okay, it's done more or less intuitively. So that's why I put it between the quotes. Yeah. Please.
Some of us might argue that in science, at least, the underlying informal logic really is paraconsistent or often is relevant. So it's very natural for us to say, look, there's no relationship between the premises and the conclusions, so how can that be valid? Right? So that's a relevant thought. And that would be true of a underlying. So I think one could make a much stronger claim that that a lot of the underlying informal logic actually is quite often paraconsistent or relevant in some circumstances.
Yeah, I think you are right, and of course this is one of the reasons to study paraconsistent logics and so on. On the other hand, while a number of people will fight this, you will have experience just as me that if you talk to mathematicians and you talk about paraconsistent logic, they say, yeah, this is, but I go on and do my business. I don't want to hear about it, okay? We'll see.
Right. So they don't recognize that that's what they're doing, but they actually are doing it.
Yeah. On the other hand,
it makes sense of what they're doing.
If we are not able to convince them, I think we should go on to argue, because it's not sufficient that we convince ourselves. Okay? We have to convince them also. And we should also, I think, I would not consider what you just said as final or as established. It's an impression we have. I'm all on your side, of course, but let's go on and argue about it, because sometimes what logicians have said about para consistency was exaggerated. Okay, good. So to explicate, I have to go a bit quicker, I think, to explicate reasoning and functional applications, but don't stop interrupting. It is believed that this also worked with classical logic, and you can again, of course, and there are certain things like in quantum mechanics, whenever I talk about a person that has some feeling for logic and who is really doing quantum mechanics, these, they will immediately, after a very short discussion, say, but you cannot do it with classical logic. You cannot do it with classical probability theory, because it all goes berserk if you do that. So they will immediately be on your side. But if you talk about a more physicist that is not himself or herself doing work in quantum mechanics, they are very, very reluctant usually to accept that. Okay, so but again, this is an argument for pluralism. There are a number of that. There is also the transfer between theories, because since some of these theories will be paraconsistent, some will use different logics than others, and so on. How can you put them together is a problem. I will not say much about this, but Bryson is here and will talk about it. I understood in this workshop. So. There will be some time for discussion at that point, but there are other things that you could use. Even the old Rashid-Mahler mechanisms could be used in a sense for those kind of purposes. But more of this will come up, and I think I made sufficiently clear what the problem is. Okay. Would it be possible that I go over there? I think it would be much easier for me to... No, leave it here. No, that's okay. That's okay. It would just be better from here to... Yeah, so... Yeah, I will go very quick over this. Oh, I forgot my watch, which is crucial. I will go rather quickly over this. You want to explicate actual reasoning, you can split that up. There's deductive logic and there's deductive reasoning and defeasible reasoning. In the deductive, you have formal and non-formal reasoning. And then if you look closer at those, you will see, first of all, that there are a lot of logical terms that are used. Cause on causal relations, time and tense, the ontic operators, some of them at least are logical terms, and you do not find them among the traditional logics. Okay, so this is a point of that. And then why should these terms be unique? Why should there be only one negation? Why can't we have classical negation and a paraconsistent negation in the same context, or even a paraconsistent negation and an intuitionistic negation? Or things like that. Okay, now there are certain problems to put them together technically, but if you can do it, why not? And if you look at the reasoning and try to explicate it, why should we think that all these knots mean the same thing? There's absolutely no reason, seems to me, to believe that. And we have, because I write negation here, and it's clear for everybody, there are many negations in logic, there are many implications in logic, this is obvious, but even for conjunctions that you have things like fusion and fission that get close to a conjunction and a disjunction but are quite different. So there are examples, and there are more and more examples of logical terms that are different from the traditional truth functional operators. And then there are many ambiguous logical terms, of course, and there's no reason why they should occur in the same context. So it is possible that in some context you get some terms and in other context you get other terms. I told you I would go fast. Then there's also a point, if we try to explicate reasoning, why should we do that in... Why should there be only one logic that is able to do that? I will later come to the notion of satisficing, but it's possible that several logics do it equally good. And then if we find one that does it well, okay, let's apply it and let's see what comes up. And maybe later somebody
finds a failure or a weakness in that, and then you have to change, but not beforehand. Okay, so always try to write the result here and then. Yeah, maybe it is important. There are some people who think that if you talk about the logic, then you have to use the logic itself, because otherwise there is a problem. I really do not see what is good about that or why that is necessary. It's a nice technical property that the logic is able to describe itself more or less adequately, but why should it be in that place? I do not see it. Okay. And then, yeah, this, some people argue against logical pluralism that if there are different contexts in which different logics have to be applied, then nevertheless there must be a kind of umbrella logic that tells you, oh, in that kind of context use this, in that kind of context use that, and so on and so on. Now, this umbrella logic is not a logic in our sense of the term logic. Okay, that cannot be a logic. A logic is something in which even an infinity of logical terms can be defined in it. That's why I wrote these such things like that. But it's quite obvious that such an axiom system or a rule system or whatever, or semantics, is unable to tell us if this is the context, then use those logical terms. So that's not a logic. It should be something very different and not a unique, not a logic. So there is no unique logic, I would argue.
Sorry, but why would that not be a logic?
Because if it has to tell you, given the properties of the context, you have to use those logical terms that I define here, then this is not like a system of, well, it's not an axiomatic system or a rule system that gives a meaning to these logical terms. That cannot at the same time give a description of possible context and when the terms are to be applied.
Okay, well, we can talk more. Okay.
Okay. Okay. I have really to jump. For referring terms, we get all the same plus more, namely many referring terms are either vague or ambiguous. Many are theory laden, and so whenever something changes to the theory, the meaning of the term will change. Okay, so it has nothing to do with incommensurability here, but you have more reasons for pluralism. You have even more reasons for pluralism when you get to methodological reasoning, because there the idea is that you have a logic in the broad sense that characterizes a method, that tells you how to react to a certain situation. So there come in the things that I said about epistemic pluralism. Okay? And then it turns out, but I return to that later, that for some complex theories, you can define some complex theories with the help of defeasible logics, and that gives you something very different from the kind of semi-recursive theories we are used to. And in some cases, they seem to be very interesting, I would argue. Okay. I could go to jump to these logicians at once. How do you justify this charge? Well, that's where I bring in the satisficing. And when I did it, talked about this before, everybody knows what satisficing means. No. You look at the things until you find a suitable candidate, and then you say, this is all right. My comparison was, if you look for a partner, you do not optimize. That means you are not going to look at all the potential partners, which is half of mankind, and give them all a certain figure, evaluating them along different lines, and then adding up, making a weight average, and then saying, who comes out the highest with the highest figure? You don't do that. You at some point find somebody that you think, well, this person is sufficiently aware, and then you go for it. But it's the same with the logic. This is an idea of
Herbert Simon
from Carnegie Mellon University. This is an idea from the 60s, I think. Dissatisfying, but I think it's a very important thing. I should be aware because two years later I had to referee a paper, and somebody wrote there that I had said, if you are looking for a woman, I never said that. I said, if you are looking for a partner, okay, I'm not a sexist. So what you do in practice, I think, is you pick a choice, you take a logic of which you think this is all right, this will do in this situation. And then if it turns out that there are certain weaknesses, you change it by another logic, and that's it. Good. Yeah, I will not try to explain this because that's a bit of will take too long time, too much time, and that's a bit of complex thing. Next point is this thing on when inconsistency emerges. What I wanted to do here was just take one example and then show that there are many alternatives. Now, in view of the time, what I propose to do is go rather quickly over the alternatives and spend more time on the seven theses, because I think this will be more interesting for the discussion. Okay. What I had in mind is something that I've been actually working on for quite a while, namely the situation in which you have a theory that is intended to be consistent, but that later turns out to be inconsistent. There are quite a few examples. I think the most famous one is Frege's set theory, but there are a number of other examples also from the empirical sciences. So the point is, you start with a theory that has classical logic as its underlying logic, and then it turns out to be inconsistent, so literally it's trivial, and what do you do then? Now, what most sensible people, I think, will do in the first place is to try to find a replacement for the non-logical axioms. So let's find another set of axioms that gives us a consistent theory, but that is sufficiently close to the inconsistent theory we just have. But you don't do that by throwing away the first theory and starting from scratch. What you do is you reason from the trivial theory and you try to get to something non-trivial. Okay? So you reason. Think about what Russell did after his famous letter to Frege and that at the set theories that came out of there and that. Good. So there are two aspects to this, and call them P1 and P2. P2 is that on the one hand, you try to locate the inconsistencies. But this is not obvious if the theory is trivial, so it must mean something different. Try to locate the inconsistencies, and the good way to do that is look for an interpretation of the theory that is as consistent as possible. So you see, it was intended as consistent, turns out to be inconsistent, but nevertheless, let's try to interpret it as consistent as possible. Once you have that, then you take the next step, how to transform this to a consistent theory. Now, this is not a matter of logic, because what you do there is maybe you look for new empirical data, you look for what is conceptually most systematic, especially in mathematical theories, and so on and so on. Okay, but this is not a logical matter. Of course, if you have one of these methods for doing this, you can call it a logic. It will map a certain premise set to a certain consequence set, but you cannot predict what are the interesting logics. It's completely big out of reach. Whereas on the other hand, P1, we can say some things about it. Now, there are quite a few approaches about P1. We'll review some of the candidates. One of the approaches is that you just go paraconsistent. You say, well, classical logic gave me triviality, I replace it by a paraconsistent logic, and now it's not trivial anymore. It's not difficult to act. It's true, right? It's not trivial anymore. But the point is that what you get then is, and I'm running now in this part, so I propose if you don't agree, let's move into the discussion. But you can easily show that if you take just a paraconsistent Tarski logic, that's why Michel was laughing, then you, what you got is much too weak. Okay, it's an interestingly weak. So that doesn't work. No Tarski logic offers a good approach. By Tarski logic, I mean logic that is reflexive, transitive, and monotonic. Then there are procedures. By procedure, I mean a set of instructions that lead from a premise set to a conclusion, to a conclusion. A set of instructions. And what do I mean by an instruction? Well, it's a rule on the one hand, but attached to the rule is a permission or an obligation that functions, that works in function of what you have already, of the reasoning that you have already. So your procedure tells you, this is your problem, okay, take that step, take the next step, and so on. At some point it will say, given that you have these results of your steps, now you have to do that rather than that, and so on. Of course, the instruction can be more or less deterministic, that's not so important. So in function of the state of the construction and the function of the premise set, you take steps. Okay, so you can see your logic in the narrow sense as, I find this kind of funny, as a procedure with universal permission to it. When you think about a Tarski logic, you have a set of rules and it tells you, well, you can do whatever you want, apply these rules. Pick any choice you want. Okay, as long as you apply the rules, it is correct. Of course, you can get a lot of boring and uninteresting proofs in that. Okay. I'm not defending procedures over logic, I'm just describing. Okay, you can approach the problem I considered in terms of a procedure. And some interesting things come out, and well, I refer to a specific procedure here that I call CL minus. It is nicely described, but I'm going to jump it rather than go through that. And the idea of the CL minus is that you really obtain your conclusion from the premises. You basically do not apply transitivity. You do not reason from things that you have derived from your premises, but you always reason straight from the beginning from the premises. And then you see whether you can obtain what you want to obtain. What this gives you is that if your premise set is consistent, it gives you exactly the same consequence set as classical logic. If your premise set is inconsistent, it gives you a consequence set that is non-trivial, except in bolder cases. But in general, it's not trivial. And on the other hand, it's a paraconsistent logic. One of the things you can say about it, if you are a consistent subset of your premises, then everything that is with classical logic derivable from that is derivable with your CL minus directly from the full set of premises. We have a number of properties like that. So it's paraconsistent, reflexive, and monotonic, but it's non-transitive and not even cautiously transitive. I mean, even adding consequences to the thing, whatever follows from that does not follow from the original premises. Okay? So if something follows from the premises and from consequences of these premises together, then it need not follow from the premises alone. So in that sense, it's not cautiously transitive. Okay? That was one approach, sorry, and you may of course have objections to the fact that it is in no way transitive and so on and so on, and how sometimes you have too much, I would guess, but okay. Then you have inconsistency adaptive logics. I will not say much about this because that's otherwise I never stop, so I have only a few things about it. So there the idea is that you consider inconsistencies as false until and unless it shows that you cannot consider them as false in view of your premises. So basically, from your premises, you will be able to derive certain disjunctions of inconsistencies. And those formulas, there's something funny with them. You have to take that into account, that something is disjunct of a minimal disjunction of inconsistency. There are different strategies to handle that, but that's the basic ideas. Okay, I think I can't. The interesting thing is that this has a dynamic proof theory, unlike many other mechanisms. Namely, you can reason, that you reason more or less like in a classical proof, in the sense that you write down, I've derived this by that, think about an annotated proof, okay? You give your lines numbers, you derive formulas, you tell them from what you derive them and by what rules. And then what is new here is that this comes on a certain condition. This is a set of abnormalities, we call it technically, that should be false in order for the formula of the line to be derivable. And that shows exactly in terms of these disjunctions of abnormalities that are derivable. I think this gives you an idea, and now I stop talking about this thing. I have a little comparison here. Sometimes it gives you less than the CL minus, but I think that's better. If you are quick enough, with CL minus you can derive S from that, notwithstanding the fact that you have both Q and not Q. With an adaptive logic, with most adaptive logics, you do not want to derive S from not Q or S, because you say, well, this is just trivial consequence of not Q. And if it is all right to derive S from this, then you can derive whatever. Okay, because... Okay. So, I think this is not important. It's just sufficient that I try to show you there are very different mechanisms to arrive at such, to do this P1 task, to arrive at a maximally consistent interpretation of your premise. And then I say something about Rasher-Meyer mechanisms. Of course, what Bryson will be talking about does the same thing, but I consider it as related. No, it is one of them. It does, among other things, that. To some extent. Now, with this here, the idea is, that's the very old stuff, that you have an inconsistent set, you split it up in marginally consistent subsets, and then you define consequence relations like what follows from all marginally consistent subsets, for example. That are the strong consequences. You can do things like that. This can be characterized by an inconsistency adaptive logic under a translation. But it makes a hell of a difference. Why is it important that you characterize them like that? Because then you have a dynamic proof theory. I mean, you can sequentially write down steps that otherwise, with the rational mechanism, you cannot write down. Imagine if you are in predicate logic and you have to look for maximal consistent subsets. That's kind of okay, because it's not decidable whether a set is inconsistent. Well, there's a positive test for inconsistency, but not for consistency. Okay, now there are many similar. There's one thing I want to mention, and then I can move to the theory. Yeah.
You are live right now.
Sorry. Maybe I will say there are. If you have a premise set like this, then we tend to think there is a problem of inconsistency here, which is correct. But what we have to do is, in some or other way, interpret the negation as weaker than a classical negation. It has to be a paraconsistent negation in one way or other. But that's not correct. You can just as well say, oh, there's a problem with the conjunctions here. There are conjunction gaps. There are cases where A and B are true, but the conjunction of them, A and B, is false. And then you also have modes. If you allow conjunction gaps, and if you allow disjunction gluts, meaning disjunctions that are true even if none of their members is true, then you also have a model for this premise. Okay? And then you can, again, minimize the abnormalities, in this case, the gluts of the gaps. And so in this way, you get another huge set of minimally abnormal interpretations, so minimally inconsistent interpretations of your premise. So what I want to show is there is a huge domain, a huge set of possibilities by which we may proceed. That's okay. Okay. Now none of these things can be done as an application of classical logic itself. There are some people that think, for example, that these rational mechanisms are actually classical logic. That's not correct. Okay, now I come to the thesis.
You have 5 minutes more, don't worry.
Okay.
Don't worry.
I better worry a little bit because otherwise. There will be only negative time for this. Don't trust me. Okay. So, this is one. Paraconsistent logics are really needed. There are at least three kinds of contexts. First of all, where inconsistency emerges, what I was just talking about. Then, if you want to talk about counterfactuals, and then also if you want to talk about law-like statements about causality, because no way to see how you can do this without reasoning about counterfactuals. And then finally, there are some interesting theories about empirical and mathematical theories that are inconsistent. Now, let me at least say you this, given that I've only 5 minutes more than, let me say you this, that I've been working for the last year and a bit on a Frege kind of sub-theory with the following properties. And there are, Peter Verdee has some results that come close to that, but that I do not like for some or other reason. I hope that what I have is a little bit nicer, but nevertheless, he has published things. My stuff is not published, but nevertheless. What this thing does is the following. It keeps going out from Frege's idea that a set is the extension of a predicate, if you put it a bit sloppy. Of course, there are some inconsistent sets, like the Russell set and some other sets, but, well, that's no problem. They do not lead to triviality. And what is more, if you organize your adaptive logic, that's the underlying logic, in the correct way, you can have such a Frege set theory as an extension of, for example, NF, Quine's new foundation, or as an extension of ZFC. So that means you can say this part is about the consistent sets, and sets of sets, and so on and so on, and eventually classes. And then there is more. Okay, there you have the Russell set, and you have the set of sets that are members of themselves, and so on and so on. And you have a universal, in the case of NF, the universal set is already among the consistent ones. For ZFC, of course, it will be in the inconsistent part. But so then what is the point? You can understand Frege's idea, you can apply that, you can use his idea for the definition of what is a set, but at the same time you have a certain fragment of your theory that does exactly the same thing as what is classically done by our present apparently consistent set theory. Okay, so you have theorems in the form of, if set of C is consistent, then this thing has the properties I just described. Okay, and so I think this is very interesting because you can also show that it's impossible to have such a construction if you use a Tarski logic. The typical thing is that the underlying logic should be defeasible. It should be a logic where certain things are only defeasibly consequences. Okay. Now, this is one. The arguments refers to the history of science, of course. What has this to do with logical pluralism? But I spelled it only out for the first case. The fact that there is a multiplicity of such things, I just gave you the examples before. And we have some knows and some ideas about when to apply which logic. And then, of course, it's a matter of satisfying, but there are some criteria that we know there and have. Second thesis, it is impossible to decide now whether our best future theories will be consistent or not, or inconsistent. I think what is a very strong argument for this, the world may be so complex that it cannot be described by the enumerable language. We all suppose that our languages are denumerable, otherwise you don't have the downward Lernaus-Kolan theorem. So we always presuppose our languages are denumerable. But if the world is more complex than it is possible that it has only an inconsistent description in a denumerable language. Now, of course, I did not say that the world is so complex. I just said you cannot rule this out. We don't know at the moment. Okay. So, what has this to do with logical pluralism? Well, if the true logic exists, it is not knowable today. The true logic would be what is the logic of our monolithic body of knowledge at the end of time. But we have no idea what that would be, right? So, the true logic depends in part on the world and not on many other things, the usual things that traditional logicians bring up. And next, if the true logic exists, then it is completely useless for us now. This logic that will be adequate at the end of time, that will be part of the language of science, well, that does not help us to do the difficult steps we have to do now, namely to transform science until we get that final stage. It's no use. We need something else now. Okay, so third thesis. Even inconsistent theory is translated, now I go a bit more in the conservative direction, or what some people consider conservative. Even inconsistent theory is translated without laws of discrimination into a consistent theory, then it turns out that the new theory allows for more discriminations. It's more precise than the old one. So moving towards consistency is good. It's a step forward. Now beware, there's no standard, there's no algorithm for doing this, and very often it cannot be done. We often reach consistency not in this way, by keeping all the distinctions, but by giving up certain things. For example, the set theories that we think to be consistent today are obtained by throwing out a number of things. So these things are not sets. Okay? Don't worry about that. We do. So that has nothing to do with T3. T3 is, but sometimes you can apply T3. We will see it in a minute. T4. Well, suppose, first of all, that you have a paraconsistent logic. And then you define a logic L1 by saying we just pick the consistent models. So your logic has certain consistent models. And by just picking those, you say that defines. So a premise set, the consequence set of L1 is defined by saying all consistent L models of gamma are all verify A. Then A is a consequence of gamma in L1. Paperized? Because you look suspicious. Okay, now whenever you do that, then your L1 consequence set of gamma is non-trivial, because gamma has L1 model, has consistent models, and secondly, it is richer than the L consequence set. So it's a step forward. I think you can argue this even better than what I said now, but I try to explain it here, but I really have to Okay, we can come back to that if somebody would not believe it, but I think it is rather trivial. So this is a reason to restrict logical pluralism to some extent. Okay, if you can go with a logic that has as far support in that, if you can do the job with that logic, it's better to use that logic than the paraconsistent version. T5, if some of our best theories are inconsistent, or if the best unified theory is inconsistent, then it is almost straightforward that you can find a consistent meta level, that you can find a level at which you talk in a consistent way about all the theories and all the knowledge down there. For example, it is possible that A and not A are theorems of T, but it does not follow from that that A is and is not a theorem of T. Okay? And even if it would be the case that for some A and for some theory T, A is and is not a theorem of T, whatever that would mean, then you still can reason at the meta level and say, and there is no reason why at that meta level you would have an inconsistency. You would just state that as theorems of the meta level and not the next inconsistency. Now, I cannot imagine, so my main argument is from lack of imagination. I cannot imagine what it would mean that they come crop up new inconsistencies whenever you go higher. I cannot see where they could come from. What could be the mechanism generating them? Okay? Sorry. So what this tells you is that even with all sympathy for logical pluralism, you can't find a consistent highest level that offers you a kind of coordinated umbrella view on the theories, even if they are, and there is the pluralist, even if they are some consistent, some inconsistent, or using very different logics, some constructive, non-constructive, and so on and so on. Okay. I will give you the slides, Bryce, because this six. It is objectionable, it's immediately related to the preceding thing. It's objectionable to define a higher level inconsistency from a lower level inconsistency. And I think I've seen people doing this on Octavia Thomas. Seen this book. Okay. So some people say, well, what do I mean by A is not an null consequence of gamma? Well, this is true whenever not A is an null consequence of gamma. But this is just pushing up your inconsistencies to higher levels without any need to do that. Okay? I make some comparisons, but I will skip those because I mentioned Grand Priest here. It's not it's somewhat similar but less objectionable, and it's more conventional than whatever. So let me skip this and move to the final thesis. And then I will jump to the end of the conclusion, where the theory is rejected or modified or replaced. The replacement may affect the non-logical axioms, but also the logic. Changing your logic is also a good means to replace a theory. There's nothing wrong with that. Now, this has an important consequence, because what does it mean? It means that, in principle, there are certain possibilities that you do not take into account. I will come back on that in the next workshop, because it's clearly related to that. But as a theory, the thing will work very nice. Okay? And there is a relation even with Hampel's theoretician's dilemma, but that was not about the formal part of the logic, that was only about the concepts, I think. Good. So, the underlying logic of a theory, in the sense of a discipline or a subdiscipline, this underlying logic need not be stable over time, it's absolutely not necessary. Okay, jumping to the conclusion, I will only give you the first page of the conclusion and then jump to the end. The rest is some answers to questions that you put, and of course I will give them to you, but in your call for papers. I think from what preceded you can attempt, no, maybe answer to, this is more interesting, sorry. If several competing theories exist or coexist, then of course you have a good reason to know all of them if you want to have a competent view in the domain. And if there are several disciplines that offer you, for example, an explanation on some phenomenon, then you better have to look at all of them, because it is interesting to combine them, to figure out why is it that, for example, I have a sociological explanation that I cannot express in psychological terms. So that poses an interesting problem about the cooperation between psychology and sociology. But you can do the same for the exact sciences, okay? So the idea there is that the first thing has to do with competing things. So you have to figure out which is the good theory and which is the bad one, and can help to go to the, for that problem. For the second problem is related to your unification. Okay? How can we get closer to this unification idea? Okay. I think I can jump to if there is any. I will do it like that. That will also work. But at least to show. Sorry.
Thank you.
I wanted to show that I could also put in a slide that moves. Sorry for taking so much time, but I hope we still have some time for discussion.
Yeah, we have. I have questions.
I have a question about, I think, thesis 5 about the mental model. Because, of course, even the, as you know, even the idea of separating levels, object level, mental level, is something that's contested, right? Why should we even accept that way of framing the debate, which already seems to privilege a certain conception of logic, right? But even if we grant that, someone may say, look, once you move to the meta level, you're talking about something else. You're no longer talking about whatever objects you're interested in. So suppose you're trying to figure out what's going on in the world, and it turns out that there are some inconsistencies that we cannot get rid of. And then, yeah, but the meta level that I invoke in order to talk about the language I need to talk about the world is consistent. So yeah, suppose that that's the case. You can always make it consistent, you know, kind of, but it talks about something else. And mm-hmm. So it's unclear what exactly is gained by preserving consistency at that level.
The point I was trying to, this is not an argument against paraconsistency. Mm-hmm. There remains a consistency at the object level.
Right.
The world, if you describe it as part of the world, an aspect of the world is inconsistent. But at least our reasoning about that, if the what I call the meta level then is consistent, that means we have a consistent view of the theory we have, which makes the theory much better in view of the other, which makes the theory, the other thesis, which makes the theory much better. So the world is consistent. Your theory about it, of course, has to take into account of this inconsistency, but I said it wrong, I think. The world is inconsistent. Your theory has to take this inconsistency into account, if it is to be a true theory, and has to describe it. But it is a good theory because we can consistently reason about this theory.
Well, the reasoning about this theory is not all the reasoning about the world.
No, of course not.
That's with something entirely different.
Yeah,
so, why not? Yeah. So that's my question. So what exactly is gained by that level of consistency?
What is gained out your reasoning, that your theory is better if you can describe it in a consistent way. That's the claim. So your inconsistent theory about the world is a better theory if you can consistently reason about it.
What if, for the same reason you think that your better theories are inconsistent, if your world is inconsistent, what if the same applies to the language you reason about that thing.
So then you have to, if that turns out to be the case, then of course that is the case. You have to take that into account. And you have to move up a level.
Okay.
What's the problem? No, no. But of course I do, I'm not arguing at this moment for, I'm not saying the meta language should be consistent. I was only talking about the highest level. Okay? So there is a highest level at which you can reason consistently, and then you can describe your levels that are below in a better way, in a more precise way, than if you reason at the top level inconsistently. Of course, I mean reasoning consistently, you use a paraconsistent logic in which there is no classical logic, no classical negation, of which classical logic is not a fragment. I am not talking about like Acosta's logic, of course, all contain classical logic. This is different. But if you have a strictly paraconsistent logic in which you cannot define explicitly define classical negation or bottom, then even bottom, if you have no material implication, round implication with bottom will not still not give you classical negation. So I think my claim is, if you have classical negation at your highest level, you are off back, and your description is more precise. And then all the several levels below will be inconsistent, no problem.
And it's more precise. I know that that's a thesis six, but six or four.
Isn't that it's more precise, or it's just a preference that it is easier to reason consistently?
That would be a different claim. I think that's right.
It would at that moment, you come to the trivial case of T3, you come to a case where you can apply T3. Because if you are at the highest level, you can do that either inconsistently. So if look at this thing first. Here, if you can say PX, but you cannot exclude, if that is the only negation, you cannot exclude that you are here. You cannot exclude that not PX is also true. You say PX, you can say not PX, but in many logics that means exactly the same thing. So you cannot distinguish between these two boxes. Okay? Whereas if you are here, if you do it consistently, you say I use positive P for P and I use negative P for what is there, not P. And then what you get is here positive P and negative P is absent, positive P and negative P are both present, positive P is absent but negative P is present. No, it's completely consistent, it's two different predicates. And this thing here you can say I'm here, I'm not there, by just uttering that thing. So in that sense it is more precise.
Are you saying something different?
Yes, yes, you're saying something different, but given the situation I described, namely you have a set of theories on different levels and some consistent, some inconsistent, and then you go one level higher, there you can give.
But I think then the disagreement is there's a difference between being able to give a consistent and, let's say, more elaborate. And it looks like it's more precise if you want to remain consistent. But if you want to describe the reality of the theory, and which describes the reality of the world, both of which are inconsistent, then you might want to think of yourself as more precise by remaining inconsistent. Is that your point?
Right. Yeah. Okay. But I don't see that. If suppose you say some rabbits are not rabbits. Okay? Why are you now making this more precise by saying, from what I said, follows that some rabbits are not rabbits, but also follows that does not follow that some rabbits are not rabbits.
Yeah, well, I would say you've just been confused. But, if you were to say that, no?
What's the Yeah, that's not the right question. I was going to say what's the gain in doing it paraconsistently there, but I wrote this down in a paper once, and Graham even agreed, but he argued that, and it's also in writing, he argued that the whole construction may be inconsistent. Okay, the box may be inconsistent, the drawing, as he called it. Yeah, that's correct, but that's a possibility. If it doesn't, why should I take this possibility into account? It's like we know since Gödel that classical arithmetic may be inconsistent. Okay, we cannot prove by simple means that it is consistent. Papa arithmetic, yeah, okay, piano arithmetic. We cannot prove by means as simple as piano arithmetic that it is first incompleteness theorem. Okay. So is that now a reason to describe classical arithmetic in a paraconsistent way?
No, but
it's a possibility that it is wrong, and then when we find out that it is wrong, we will have to make a movement, of course.
I think that's a different issue, right? That's an issue about whether we know that it's consistent or not, and whether it is consistent or not. Those are, I think, this is a separate issue. Here we're not raising an epistemological issue. At least I took it, right?
Suppose you say I have a theory that is as true as, is there anything to write in the neighborhood? Because not.
Well, only
in the race. Good university.
Yes. No, I write here. No, I know. I am a philosopher. I'm not. I'm older than you, Maria. So
we are live.
Okay. So now suppose that P and not P come out true, and suppose now you have your theory T. And that gives you P as a consequence of it, and not P is also a consequence of it. But why do you want to say that in the meta language that these are both true? What? Sorry, that is all right, of course, but that's the same as this. But what is the use of having P and why is that? Because you say if once the object theory is inconsistent, you should in some other way have your meta theory also inconsistent. That is, I think you were claiming that this is more coherent, or
well, at least if you have reasons you think that the phenomena you're dealing with requires some inconsistency, well then your theory will reflect better if it is inconsistent.
Let me put it differently. We have paraconsistent logic. Okay? If you want to make a completeness proof, you have semantics, you have it's somewhere in the slides. So if you make your consequence relation of your logic paraconsistent, it seems what you are arguing, your paraconsistent logic allows for inconsistencies at the object level, right?
Yeah.
It allows for it. It does not affirm them, but it allows for it. So now, if you move to the meta level and you use the same language, then again you have a paraconsistent logic in the meta language. Mm-hmm. Okay. So now, how are you going to make your completeness proof? Because the problem is, traditionally, we make completeness proof by saying if from gamma we cannot derive A, then A is not a semantic consequence of that. Mm-hmm. But if you use the definition, it's in my slides, let me...
You cannot do that consistently in a classical...
No, it is about this being objectionable. I think it should be... Where is it? It's here. Yeah. So if you have this, you lose your completeness proof completely, because you have A is not an L consequence of gamma, B
because not A is an L consequence of grammar. Okay? The second implies the first. That's the idea. To push up your inconsistencies to a higher level.
Okay.
So then you have that from A, not A does not follow A by LP, for example, Gram's LP, because not A is derivable from it, so A is not derivable from it. It's also derivable from it, but at the same time not derivable from it. Okay? But of course you do not in any way have this in the semantics. You do not have that, that there is no model in which A and not A are true, is true and A is false.
Okay, well.
So if you want a paraconsistent logic in describing your paraconsistent logic, then you lose your completeness proof, it seems.
Oh, well, it depends on the framework you run your completeness proof, right? So you can prove in a paraconsistent set theory, you have your completeness theorem with.
How can you express consistency of mode? Because, for example, the Zach Weber can't express consistency in his inconsistent set theory.
Yeah.
Yeah, but then you have what you want to have, right? Or no?
Well, it depends on what it's there.
wait a second. No, we got it. I see the point you are getting at, but. So maybe it didn't
It's a difference in the conception of soundness,
yes. Right?
Sorry? It's a difference in the conception of soundness. That you want the soundness to go paraconsistent from the meta level. Or you would consider the meta theory to be sound, if and only if it is also paraconsistent.
Right.
Whereas Dirac would say it's not sound, that should not be considered, those should not be considered valid inferences at the meta level.
Yeah, but that means, in a way, sort of, that's the worry. You distort the phenomena when you make it consistent.
Right. So,
the inconsistent.
So the tension seems to be one between whether we can reason meaningfully, which is very difficult for a lot of people to do, to reason non-causically without bracketing or doing something, and a notion of ultimate precision or something, mm-hmm. and preserving the fact that something is inconsistent, trying to get used to it. Like, mm-hmm. you know, even at the meta level. So I'm just trying to outline the difference.
Yeah.
I understand what you, you use the kind of notion of coherence. What I do not understand is in which sense, well, you can call it coherence, but in which sense goes anything wrong if you describe your paraconsistent theory by means of a classical mental map? I do not see what you lose in the description. I think the description is more precise, as I argued in this D4.
Yeah, I think you lose the phenomena you're trying to capture. Mm-hmm. It would be something like, I'm going to give you a formulation of the Bayer paradox, but it turns out to be consistent, right? And then you say, well, then you're not over the Bayer.
No. It's not consistent. You come up with it. The Lyot paradox will be true, and its negation will also be true. Or if you want to use true and false in the sense of Gram, the Lyot paradox will be true and it will also be false. Fair enough. But you can say this, both of these are true claims, and it is not so that they are also false.
Yeah, but then, well. Okay, well, I took a lot of time, so we can continue so other people can.
Is there another question? No. Like 10 minutes?
Most people are.
Most people are.
We can always ask
you
questions,
but other people should be here.
We were all tied up with this kind of discussion, perhaps, and now everybody.
It's just towards giving a consistent description. I mean, there are, you know, ambiguity-based approaches that just make the inconsistency disappear if that mm-hmm. description. And you get the same consequence relation, you're describing the same consequence relation, so you're preserving the consequence relation that you want, but you recognize that, oh, well, we can just take care of that by acknowledging there's ambiguity there. So at that level of description, we're not worried about it, right? We can be quite happy to offer a consistent account of this inconsistency.
But even this is, well, even that is not what I was claiming, I think. I was claiming something.
Yeah,
yes, there's a can claim, then it's a should claim, right?
But, well, my only should thing is with respect to the precision.
But it might be a false precision, I think, is what Octavio said.
Yes.
It's a precision that loses a phenomenon, that tension that arises from the inconsistency. So it looks more precise in the sense that you have more stuff. There's more written down. And there's a way of disentangling.
I go back to my T4, but the other people, especially those that are bored by this discussion, you should figure out the questions you have, please, because there are many other questions or things that I said. This was not this one I wanted to show.
It's when you're more precise.
The
boxes.
Yes.
Yeah. Sorry?
More boxes and fewer boxes. Yeah. You said replace.
What was that, six?
I don't know. It was replace once in a box and you come back. So the claim is that the second one is more precise, but Octavio's claim is going to be, it might be more precise in the same sense that you've disentangled what is going on in the top set, and you've disentangled it by showing it to be, in some sense, consistent now once again. But Octavio's point is that you're going to then lose that tension that was arising from the first set, which said, hey, there's something fishy going on, there's something inconsistent going on, I want to preserve that, even at the meta level.
Yeah. No. First of all, I think I preserved that tension at the level where it appeared. There's absolutely nothing that was moved away there. The other thing, this notion of precision is in that sense important, that whatever distinction you have here, so you can say px, not denying not px, but still you can say px, you can say both, or you can say not px. These distinctions are retained if you go to the richer language. That's what I meant by retain, without loss of discrimination. But it doesn't work the other way around, in the sense that here you can say things that you cannot say there. And now I do not see why this would be worse in any sense as a description of the original theory.
How is it retained, right? At the object level, you have an inconsistency, right? And you lost that when you precisify, right?
No. This is not at the object level. This is by no means at the object level.
No, whenever you replace, right, so look, I have these three possibilities, and now replacing by these different three possibilities, but now I'm introducing these extra predicates, right, that I didn't have before. Before I only had P, now I have positive P, negative P, and when I do that, lo and behold, the inconsistency vanished. Right.
So suppose we are at the meta level of inconsistent theory, and you have this paraconsistent description of it. Okay, so these are at the meta level.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so then what you do is indeed you say whatever criterion I use to affirm px, I now introduce to affirm ppx. At whatever criterion I had to affirm not px, I introduced pnx. Another point is, it is possible that you have no information to say I'm in this box or in that box. It's possible that all the information you have is that you are in one of the boxes. All I'm saying is that conceptually, if you get the information, you can express it with this mechanism, and there you can't.
That's right. You added new predicates in your language that will allow you to say more things. I think that's, no one's denying that. The question is whether in doing this, you've actually accomplished something better, right? You want to say, yes, you accomplished something because now I have these more fine-grained distinctions. Fair enough, I grant you that. But I think also you lost something. You lost the phenomena you're trying to capture.
But the world has still the same inconsistency, and my theory describing the world, or that aspect of the world, is still as inconsistent as before.
Right.
All I'm doing is describe my inconsistent theory in a more precise way. That's the only claim I make. And I think by doing this, my theory becomes more valuable. I know better what I say if when claiming this is a theorem of that theory, I exclude that it is not a theorem of that theory.
Right, so why did we have...
I'm sorry.
Please
come.
I think it's a similar question, but in different terms, because it's... I wonder about the scope and strength of your epistemic plurals, because it seems to me that you don't allow for the possibility that at the end of time, pluralism is right. It seems to me that you are assuming the Western ideal.
Why do you think that?
I don't know.
No, it is the world as such that it requires that we talk in our kind of languages. We have to end up with bunches of theories that are not completely integrated. And that's how I actually believe that we never will get out of the present situation. When I was talking about this end of time, it was a kind of metaphor. It's like the whole side. Okay? I'm not a theist, but it is a similar.
So in your epistemology, there is... What's the place of this? What do you say? Western idea of knowledge.
I think it's a good idea because steps in where you say I have two theories and there is a problem between them, and I can make a step forward by changing one of the theories in such a way that they are more coherent, it does a step forward and it plays an important role in the history of science. But I do not believe that we will ever get to the final theory. Of course not. I mean,
yeah, one of the games there is that you're free to reason much more coherently and across different regions. So quite often when you think about how theories get connected when the vocabularies don't mesh well or when there are conflicts, you find little traces of reasoning that will connect the two and allow you to deal with situations that seem to require both. But when you find a reconciliation that allows you to put the two together, then you're free to reason in many more ways, right? Otherwise, there are these things that get you into trouble.
May I have a follow-up?
Of course.
I'm just curious whether this kind of approach, and you had this unification as the regulative ideal, which we are using in science, whether you would go a step further and say that this also means driving for consensus, so whether unification as regulative ideal means also consensus, striving to reach consensus as a regulative ideal, and then we might get into trouble, which pluralists are not so comfortable with, that we are forcing a certain framework while dismissing fringe approaches. So we are kind of pushing consensus for the sake of unification. So how would you respond to that?
It's a while ago that I was teaching that kind of courses, but I can assure you that all those courses, I argued that it is very important that there are small fragments of the, it's not a very original idea, small fragments of the society or disciplinary matrix that go for non-standard proposals, because that's how new things come up.
Okay, but why should we then defend striving for consensus as a mean of reaching unification?
I think consensus is... Yeah, but that's, you said that, don't you?
Yeah,
I'm
asking, because what Bryson said went in that direction, so I'm just asking, would you agree with that?
In some respects, driving, well, trying out whether there is consensus, and if there is none, asking the disagreeing group what their arguments are, is a very important means towards furthering science, because people that do not have our views can criticize our views better than we can. And of course, in this sense, it is a means towards unification. But I would not, of course, I'm not, it's not a matter of it's not a matter of taking a vote, right?
There's no imposed result. Since
Okay, well, we
are. I know a university time, so. Where there was a person that was, excuse me, I know a university where there was, well, a college actually, where there was a person who, it was not in Belgium, it was in Holland, was a person who was teaching logic, a lawyer. There's nothing wrong with lawyers. I mean, I have a degree in law also, so there's nothing wrong. But he was teaching that thing, that course. And then the question was, is this a theorem or isn't it? And he solved those questions by taking a vote.
Okay, well.
So I'm not in favor of that, and neither is Bryce.
Thank you, Professor, for being here. Thank you all for coming. Yeah.
This is yours.
So we'll take a 10 minutes break and come back.